It's a pleasure seeing you in person. I've seen you in TV and
listening
to boys and cassettes and
everything.
Right.
I wouldn't want to miss this opportunity.
Wow. How about for the benefit of me, who I don't know you, how about a form of introduction?
My name is Ahmed Deedat.
Ahmed Deedat. Okay.
I'm from South Africa.
Okay.
Yes. And I guide visitors to the mosque. One of my jobs in South Africa, in Durban, is to guide tourists to the mosque, like these people in the cultural center. So we have a center, then we guide visitors to the mosque, and we get a lot of tourists coming along. More than 12,000 a year we handle. So we explain to them the relationship between ourselves and the Jews and the Christians, that almost everything the Muslim does is in your Bible. It's in the Christian Bible. I don't know whether you've been into a Muslim house of prayer. Have you been?
Yes, I have. I was in the...
The first thing you're made to do is to take off your shoes.
Except here.
And the reason behind that is that Moses, when he was on Mount Sinai, God spoke to him and he said, "Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground." In respect of that commandment, we Muslims, we take off our shoes. Before we go in for prayer, we make ablution. All the exposed parts of the body are being washed. The hands, the feet, the nostrils, the nape of the neck, gargling the mouth, brushing the teeth. This the Muslim does 5 times a day, every day of the year. The one who's particular with his prayers. And purely from the hygienic point of view, no one is going to find fault with the person who washes himself 5 times a day. It's a good hygienic practice in any country, among any community. You know, washing yourself, brushing your teeth, 5 times a day, good hygienic practice. Secondly, it serves certain psychological purposes, meaning mentally it's preparing the person for prayer. He's washing not because he's dirty. He's washing because he's going to meet his Lord. So it creates a mental attitude. Thirdly, this is also another commandment given by God Almighty to the Holy Prophet Moses in the book of Exodus. That is the second book of the Bible. It is written.
You don't mind?
No. In the second book of Exodus, it reads, "And Moses and Aaron and the son." "And Moses and Aaron and their sons washed their hands and the feet they had. When they went into the tent of the congregation, they washed as the Lord commanded Moses." So we Muslims are still fulfilling another biblical commandment. Though we haven't got the label of a Jew, nor yet that of a Christian, yet in all humility we claim that we are more Jewish than the Jews and more Christians than the Christians. In this, that we are trying to follow in the footsteps of the prophets. So this is my line of activity. I guide and answer people's questions, you know. Any question that they have, I answer. This is my pastime, hobby, or occupation.
Okay, so that's who? Ahmed Ali.
Ahmed. Deedat.
Oh, call me uncle.
Deedat. Alright, you should have told me that this was you were author of this, and then I would have looked at this and I said, "I'm by Deedat."
Call me uncle if you are not ashamed.
Oh, I'm not ashamed of anything.
So, makes it easier. See? Uncle, I can call you my son.
Alright, uncle.
Yes.
Alright. Okay, so I take it then you are the author also of...
Oh yes, I'm an author of a number of little booklets, yes.
Yes, okay.
Of these commandments that you just spoke of,
yes,
are those commandments also in the Quran to follow? Or are they in the Hadith?
No, I wouldn't be able to pinpoint. But you know, we accept that this is what they're teaching. Taking off the shoes is in the Quran. Ablution is also in the Quran. It's in the Quran that you must wash ourselves. And also in the Bible.
You have quoted the Bible.
Yes.
So I would take it then you are well read in the Bible.
Oh yes.
Oh, there is English in here.
I am well read in the Bible.
Okay. Ah. I can. Okay.
I've never read Rushdie, so I don't.
I don't either.
So I couldn't.
I don't think.
I wouldn't know what you were challenging with Rushdie because we never read Rushdie.
I don't read that kind of.
No.
If Mr. Rushdie wrote that kind of vulgarity.
That is what I want the Britishers and the Americans to know.
We don't know what he wrote.
The British and the Americans have been defending him to say freedom of speech is a right, freedom of speech.
Sure.
Like he said, now we have freedom to talk, you have a freedom to talk to me.
But,
I have no right to abuse your mother. I have no right to abuse your mother. You don't like this freedom, I can call you go man, you know, you don't know what you're talking about. And we talk like that. But now if I start abusing your mother, taking your mother's name, calling her names, then you have a right to punch to throw a punch. So in other words, now the guy went to extremes. He told things about us which hurt us very much. But at the same time, he didn't spare the Americans. He didn't spare the British. He didn't spare the black man. He didn't spare any white woman. So, but you see that because the people didn't know, we started crying, so it made people happy. People, you know, who are terrified of us, who take that we are a challenge, it made them happy. So I went on a lecture tour of Britain and America, and I spoke about how Rushdie fooled the West. How he fooled the West.
Well, guess what? I think there's three in here that he didn't fool because we don't know what Rusty is.
But the guys, the fools who said now, you know, you are locked, stock, and you know, you are for him.
Mm-hmm. Although.
So then said, so you didn't know if you read, and then if you say, no, I don't mind what he says about my mother, what about your mother,
Sure.
Then you have a right to say, look, I said, man, this is nothing. If we call your mother, and he said, no, it didn't hurt my mother. My mother is already dead and she's buried. No, that would be something. You say, no, call him your mother. And you say, no, this is a joke, man. It's only a joke. So that kind of thing. However, that is not our subject.
No, that's not our subject. But although I wanted to ask, though, do you agree with
the fatwa.
From Iran.
No, it's actually biblical. That fatwa is actually in your Holy Bible. Do you know that?
What do you mean fatwa? What do you mean by that?
Fatwa, the decree of death.
Decree of death.
The sound
of
Rushdie.
Oh, blasphemy?
Yes. That's in your Holy Bible.
Yes.
Did you know that?
Blasphemy, definitely.
Death or blasphemy? In your Bible?
Oh, sure, definitely.
Sure.
Blasphemy.
Right, so it's biblical. See, what Khomeini is supposed to have said, or a decree he had passed, is in the Holy Bible. That is biblical. Unless you say you don't accept that. You don't accept the Bible as the Word of God. Then it's different. But if you accept it as the Word of God, it's binding on you and me.
I believe that. now we are at a point where we can probably discuss. Because I do believe that it is binding upon us. Yes. Now you read it, but obviously I don't think you take it as being binding upon you.
It depends on that, you see. Because in the Holy Bible, the one that you're holding.
Yes.
We recognize three different types of evidences. We find one type of evidence where we recognize as the Word of God. You know the statements that I made. For example, Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. It reads, I will raise them up a prophet.
Yes.
I will raise them up a prophet from among the brethren, like unto thee. Like Moses. And I will put my words in his mouth.
That's right.
And he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him.
Yes.
So now I'm asking anybody, the Jew or Christian, who is this I? They say it's God.
God.
And I can also see this God talking. It's not Moses.
No, it's not.
Moses didn't say, I will raise them up. God is speaking through Moses.
Right.
So we say it is the Word of God.
Yes.
we recognize. No, no disputes. You know, between me and you, or between the Jew and us. No problem.
That's right.
He says, this is the word of God. I said, no. On the very face of it, we can see that it sounds like God talking. In the book of Isaiah, we read, God says, I am God and there's none else. I am God and there's none like me. So who's talking?
God.
Although the words, we didn't see God, we didn't hear him, but the words that are uttered by Isaiah the prophet are words as if they were put into his mouth like a mouthpiece. He was the mouthpiece of God, because these are not his words. He was not claiming divinity. Although the words came from his lips, I am God. And there's no savior besides me. Now he's not claiming that position. This is God talking through him. So he said, now we can recognize quite easily the word of God in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's another type of evidence in the Bible, which we recognize as the words of a prophet of God, like Jesus. Brother, you see, I like people when we are chatting that you give undivided attention.
Mm-hmm.
So while you are trying to see something and read something, you said that is not fair to the speaker. I feel that the common courtesy demands that when you are asking a man a question, mm-hmm. and when he's answering, you look at him. Am I right, my son? You ask me a question, mm-hmm. and then you start fumbling and start finding pages, then it's not fair to me. Am I correct?
Oh, we've made specific references.
No, that's right. Wait a minute. I want to check up. No? Where is it? Isaiah, what chapter, what verse? If I have it ready, I give it to you. I mean, that's only you're going to ask me that question if you doubt me. But if you think that's like gold, this is genuine, this quotation is coming from my book, you recognize it, then you're going to give me trouble to say, where is it? I said, Isaiah, what chapter, what verse? No, you're trying to be funny. Because you can recognize, if you know your book, that this is from your Holy Bible. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
I said, I am God and there's none else. I am God and there's none like me. You recognize that this is quoting my Bible. Unless you feel that this guy is twisting something, then say, now where is it, uncle, if you don't know? So I have to look at the reference.
But I always reference my Bible.
No, right. Okay. But suppose now it's not handy.
I always reference my Bible.
So I look at
that. So that offends you, I'm sorry.
No, not offense. You leave it up.
Okay.
Leave it up. So, word of a prophet of God, like Jesus. He said, it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her, that committed adultery with her already in his heart. That is the word of a prophet of God. God, Jesus said, I say unto you. It has been said by them of old time, that whosoever puts away his wife, let him give her a bill of divorcement. But I say unto you, that I is Jesus. And again, it has been said by them of old time, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, this is not evil. He who strikes you on the right cheek, you on the other. Now we say these are the words of a prophet of God, the mouthpiece of God. He's talking. That's the second type of evidence. Word of God, word of the prophet. Then there's a third type of evidence where we read, while he, Jesus, was going forth into the way, he saw a fig tree in the distance with leaves. Happily he came up to it, wanting to find figs thereon. But when he came, there was nothing but leaves, for the season was not yet. These are the words of an eyewitness or a ear witness of a person writing from hearsay. Three different types of evidence in the Bible. Then there is another type of evidence in the Bible which we can't attribute to God or a prophet or even to a sane person. Even to a sane person. We said, now these are lunacy of the highest order. So, and there are other types which no decent man can read out to his mother or sister or daughter or even to his fiancée if she's a good lady. Four types of evidence in the Bible. Now we in the house of Islam, we also have something like that. We have the word of God, we have the word of the prophet, we have the word of the historian, and we have also our fairy tales and pornographic material. But they are not in one book. They are not in one book. The word of God is in the Quran, The word of the Prophet is in the books of tradition, called Hadith. The word of the historian, we have our great Ibn Taymiyyah, Imam Ghazali, so on, they wrote beautiful things. Then we have our Arabian Nights, which the Arabs before Islam, they spoke around the campfire, passing time, you know, filthy, dirty stories, passing time. But that's in a separate book. The word of God is separate, the word of the Prophet is separate, the word of the historian is separate, and our pornographic material is separate. Whereas in your case, everything is in one book. That's the difference. So now you show me this, some lunacy there, and you say, now you accept this as the word of God? I said, no. But you believe in the Bible? I said, look, there are things there that I have no hesitation in accepting. Like the first commandment, the Ten Commandments, no hesitation in accepting them as God's word. But you say, now what about this? I said, no, this I don't accept. So that is the difference between us. Now actually, between us, it's a battle between two books, the black and the white, the Bible and the Quran. Now, it's what this is now. I don't know whether I appear to you that I know your Bible. I have some knowledge of your Bible. Whether you have any knowledge of the Quran? Do you have any knowledge at all about the Quran? Have you read the Quran at all?
Yes.
I'm asking.
Oh, I haven't. No.
Huh? You haven't?
No, I have not.
You have no idea. Yourself, my brother?
I've read very little.
Yourself?
I read and Hadith.
Yes.
And also.
So you see now, you know, we'll be talking about something about which you know nothing. Like an argument that corrupted between a Britisher and a German. The Britisher says, you know, Shakespeare was the greatest, artist of all times. And the German says, his Goethe or Beethoven was. You know, and the argument, debating, nearly come to blows. So somebody comes along and says, now look, wait. You're German, did you read Shakespeare? He says, no. And you're British, did you read Goethe? He says, no. What the hell are you guys arguing about? But we can share. He says, now look, this is what Goethe said, or this is what Beethoven said. This is what the Quran says, this is what the Bible says. And we can expand our knowledge on any topic. He says, now, what does the Quran say about this? What does the Bible say about that? About Jesus, for example. Jesus Christ. He is described to us in the Holy Quran as one of the mightiest messengers of God. I'm sharing this with you. We believe in his miraculous birth, according to the Quran, which many modern-day Christians, including the bishops of the Anglican Church, I think you call them Episcopals in America.
What Episcopal in
Church? Which they don't believe today, but we believe. We believe that Jesus gave life back to the dead by God's leave, and he healed those born blind and the lepers by God's leave. We are going together. The only real difference between us is the divinity of Christ. You say Jesus is God, he is God incarnate, he came down to earth, God Almighty came down to earth, he was born in the stable, circumcised on the eighth day, and at the age of 33 he got crucified for the sins of mankind. We say, no, Jesus is not God. That's the main dividing line. We say, he never claimed to be God. Nowhere in the Christian Bible, anywhere, in any version of your Bible, does he say, I'm God, or he says, worship me. It's an amazing situation.
One thing that I have to say is that
yes.
I'm probably a little bit different than some of the Christians believe, because I don't believe in the Trinity. Okay?
Right.
But I do believe in the birth of Jesus Christ as being a miracle. I also believe in him being a prophet. But I also believe that he died for our sins. And as being the ransom for our sins, being in comparison to Adam or Adam.
Right.
This is what I believe, this is what I was taught.
Yes.
And my main question in that same line is that why are we still dying? Why do we die? Why do we get old? Can you answer that question?
Have you an explanation? You see, now you must have an explanation yourself. Why are we dying? This body is not made to last forever. That's how it is. Everything that is on earth, everything that lives, must die. Everything. Unless there's something that says, look, the lions live forever. Or the donkeys live forever. That might be something. So this, everything that breathes must perish. So that's the law of nature. This body can't last for eternity.
Was the body intended to last forever?
No. If it was, then it would last it forever.
Okay, then that's my question right now. Isn't it the reason why we die now is because of the first sin?
Right. So now, everything that God made, why do the animals die? What sin? Why do animals die? What sins did they commit?
No.
Then why should they die? If you're going to die for your sins, to be logical, everything must die for some crimes, some sin. For what crimes and sins do animals die? For the sin of Adam? Does it make sense to you? For the sin of Adam, every dog, pig and donkey dies. Every flea and fly dies because Adam sinned. Does it make sense to you? No. So this body, the human body that is born, is bound to perish. The Quran says, every soul shall taste of death. Every soul shall taste of death. And everyone is destined to perish. And I'm sure you'll find verses in your Bible saying the same thing.
So that means that all of us will die as far as physical. But how about our souls or our spirits?
Right. The soul, the spirit, God tells you, when you disobey, you get punished. That is spiritual death. You disobey God, you spiritually you are dead. So physically you are alive. It says the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. Father Adam sinned. You, his children, are not responsible for Adam's sins. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. God Almighty will not question Adam and say, look, man, your children, 25 million sodomites in America. Gays, we call them gays. Hmm?
Sodomites.
Sodomites, yes. It says, 25 million sodomites. Look, what have you produced? God will not question Adam. Nor will he question us about Adam. Neither shall the son bear the image of the father. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him. Whatever good thing the good man does, he gets his fruits, his benefits. And the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. Whatever wrong things you do, you pay for it. The way to salvation is given there in the book of Ezekiel. But if the righteous shall turn from all the sins that he has committed, and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. He shall not die. But we still die. So no, that death is speaking about his soul. And I'm sure I'm worse than your Bible.
So that means that all of us will die as Christians.
So, now, this idea of Christ dying for your sins. In the first place, you say you're not a Trinitarian.
I'm not.
Right. In other words, Jesus is not God.
That's correct.
Right. Now, as a man, if he died as a man, one man can't carry the sins of the world. You see, the Trinitarian is more logical. He said, you see, he must die as a God. Because only God can pay the price for billions of souls.
That's correct.
No, he's more logical. Not necessarily that he's true.
That's correct.
But he's more logical. See? You are illogical, saying that one man carries the sins of the whole of mankind. One man carries another man's sins burden, okay? You know, somebody is prepared to get hanged for you, and suppose there is a law that allows you to do that, that guy gets killed. But you can't pay for, catch one German and pay for the 6 million Jews that is It's incinerated. Can anybody, any one human being, pay for the 6 million Jews, life of 6 million Jews? They can't. So one man can carry the sins of the world. So in other words, he's not God. The Muslims say he's not God. This guy said he's God. So he says, no, he's not God. Show me in your book where he is God. This idea of the Holy Trinity. I think it's in your book there. First episode of John chapter 5 verse 7. In your Bible.
How about in Genesis?
Are you Bible?
How about in Genesis?
No. The clearest statement on the Trinity happens to be the first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 7, where it says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one.
Yes.
That's the clearest statement.
Okay.
Other thing is, now you're going to try and hook or by crook, try and justify it. He said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and that we and us, now we're going to start debating about grammar, Hebrew grammar, Arabic grammar, and this is not. But the clearest statement on the Trinity happens to be, I think it's in your Bible.
Yes, it is.
In your Bible too?
Yes.
In your Bible as well?
I don't think so.
What Bible are you carrying?
I carry a Jehovah's Witness one.
Right. Okay. No, it's not there. It's not there. But now, you too, you carry that.
That's correct.
Yes.
But now, that is King James Version, I take it.
Yes, it is.
Yours is also King James.
Oh, yes.
Now, we have here, produced in America, the Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Revised by who? By Muslims or Jews? By Christians. Who revised them? Found Deacon Harris? No. It claims that 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they went and produced this book. 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they produce that Bible. This one here. And they threw this verse out as an interpolation, as a falsity. It's thrown out as a fabrication. Now look, we didn't do this job. The Quran says, 1400 years ago, it says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَا. Don't say Trinity. إِنْتَهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. This is stop it. It will be better for you. إِنَّمَا اللَّهُ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. For your God is one God. He's not three in one. 1400 years ago, Muhammad is meant to tell the world. He said, look, Trinity is a falsity. Stop it. Don't talk about it. Now, the Christian world has thrown it out as a fabrication. That verse, the foundation of the Trinity. So now you have to find out why do they do things like this? Your own people. And they made $15 million net profit on this before they came out with the second one. This is 1952. 1971, by that time, they had made, again, certain changes in here. But it is interesting to note what this book, these 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, what they have to say about the King James Version. You should give me opportunity. I can read it to you, what they say.
Please.
The testimony. Right, preface. I'm reading the preface.
Version
has, with good reason, been termed the noblest monument of English prose. Noblest monument of English prose. Its revises in 1881 express admiration for its simplicity, its dignity, its power, its happy turns of expression, the music of its cadences, and the felicities of its rhythm. Can you add anything to that? Can anybody add anything to that? If somebody said that about the Quran, I says, man, that's the highest tribute you can pay to a book. And they do. But I'm telling the Christians, they said, now prepare for the shock. This is so. It says, first, it says in tribute, it says, right, it's the admiration, expression, the music and spiritual. It entered, as no other book has, into the making of the personal character and the public institutions of the English-speaking peoples. We owe to it an incalculable debt to that book. You, the Western world, Britain, America, you owe this book. That incalculable. You can't calculate it. Not a shock. Yet the King James Version has grave defects. And that these defects are so many and so serious as to call for revision. So they revised it. They took out from this book the ascension of Jesus. In the four Gospels, the only two places the ascension is mentioned. Mark chapter 16, the ending verses, verse 19. And Luke chapter 24, verse 51, that Jesus went up into heaven and Jesus was taken up into heaven. Only two places in the four Gospels. In this Revised Standard Version, they threw it out as a fabrication. They put it in a footnote. Footnote is not the Word of God, it's not the Bible. The Bible is the Bible. The footnote is the editor's notes. Am I right? Footnote is not the Word of God. Any footnote, any notes that people make there, is not the Word of God. The Word of God is what is there in the main text. So they took it out as a fabrication and they threw it away. But they don't miss out. Matthew says, and Jesus rode the donkey into Jerusalem. Mark says, and Jesus rode the donkey into Jerusalem. Luke says, and Jesus rode the donkey into Jerusalem. John says, and Jesus rode the donkey into Jerusalem. Nobody missed seeing Jesus riding a donkey into Jerusalem, which every Tom, Dick, and Harry among the Jews was riding donkeys into Jerusalem. That they saw. All four. But not one of them had to say that Jesus was taken up into heaven out of the four Gospels. Yeah. Not one. They said, this is a later edition. People have added this. Because your book, the King James Version, is dependent upon the ancient manuscripts, which are 300 to 600 years after Jesus, or 400 to 600 years after Jesus, the King James Version. Now they have found manuscripts more ancient. This is now dependent upon the most ancient, which is from 200 to 300 years after Jesus. So nearer to the source, the more authentic anything can be. Nearer to the source. If in the time of Jesus the things were written, it will be more authentic than a thing written 100 years later. Because we have a tendency to add. So they said, no, in the most ancient manuscript, these verses were not there. These were later additions. So to be honest, they took them out and threw them out as fabrications. That was 1952. But by then, Bible thumpers and evangelists, this is known, man. You know, this is the kingpin of our faith. You know, your sales point. It's a great sales point. And Christ was taken up into heaven. And Jesus was taken up into heaven. And it's not here. So they protested. He says, now look, man, if you don't put that back, we won't buy the Bible. We'll tell people, don't buy this Bible. Reverse television, don't buy that. It's no good. And they'll lose sales. So, 1971, same Bible, same company, same printers, 1952, is thrown out as a publication. 1971, they put it back. Those verses are thrown out here, are in here now. But they give you an explanation why they did this. They tell you, where? In the preface. And who reads the preface? Hardly anybody. You know? And only the priests and the scholars would read, but they are not the people to tell the congregation what they read in the preface. In the preface they say, individuals and two church denominations out of the 50. Out of the 52 church denominations, they made recommendations that these must be put back, so they put them back. They're back again. Back again. What was thrown out is now put back. So you are not listening to God. If God told you take it out and you took it out, I can understand. If God told you put it back and you put it back, I can understand. But you now, you're depending upon individuals, vested interests, Bible thumpers, hot gospelers, evangelists, tele-evangelists. What they tell you, you do. Is this how you produce Word of God? Is this how God, Word of God is produced? No. So in other words, this is the handiwork of man. It's carrying on for the past 2,000 years. And even today, this minute, this King James Version of yours might be the fifth major revision. this one that you're holding there. You know, it has already gone through five major revisions. This is what I have, was presented to me by a Christian evangelist. He presented this to me. Now it's a valuable, you know, book. I didn't bring it along. But it's nice and thick, big types and all that. And I read the preface there. He said, this is the fifth major revision, major, not minor. So, and still you call it the King James Version. It's the fifth major revision. You still call it the King James. You have no right to change somebody's will, and you say still your father's will. If you add one word or delete one word, it's normal. It's nullified in any court of law, in any country. You add anything or delete anything from the will, which the testator himself hasn't done, that will be thrown out as a fabrication. Here, yeah. Fifth major revision, and still you call it the King James Version. They're doing this again, still through this. That's a continuous playing with this book. Continuous. And you know, I can give minute by minute. Minute by minute they're changing. However, the fact is that that book is not the Word of God, as you have it, per se. But the Word of God is there, the Word of the Prophet is there, the Word of the historian is there, and many things besides, which I said, no decent man can read it to his mother, or sister, or daughter, or to even to his fiancée if she's a good lady. That's the book, what you're holding there now. You can't read it to your mother. You can't read it to your sister, and you can't read it to your daughter. From one end to the other. You believe me, sir?
I believe I can read this book to anybody.
Right. I want you to read. Open. Open the Genesis chapter 19, verse 30, and read. Chapter 19, verse 30. Now you can open the Bible, yes. Chapter 19, verse 30. You too.
I'm sorry. Chapter 19?
Verse 30.
Verse 30.
That's right.
And Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain, and his two daughters with him. For he feared to dwell in Zoar, and he dwelt in a cave, he and his two daughters.
Right, carry on.
And the firstborn said unto the younger, our father is old, and there is not a man in the earth to come in unto us after the manner of all the earth. Come, let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night. And the firstborn went in and lay with her father. And he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. And it came to pass on the morrow that the firstborn said unto the younger, behold, I lay yesternight with my father. Let us make him drink wine this night also. And go thou in and lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night also. And the younger arose and lay with him. And he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. Thus were both the daughters of Lot with child by their father.
Right. Sit down.
The firstborn bare a son.
Right.
And called his name Moab. The same is the father of the Moabites unto this day.
Right.
And the younger, she also bare a son, and called his name Ben-Ami. The same is the father of the children of Ammon unto this day.
Right. Beautiful. Beautiful reading. Now your young sister, 12-year-old, she's reading that. Collecting the seed of the father. She wants to know what seed. That's it. The young child wants to know, what's seed? What's seed? And she's going to come and ask you, ask her father, ask your daddy. He said, daddy, what seed were these girls wanting to collect? No, no, no. She was going to go to an older girl at school. And he says, now, tell me, this is the collecting father's seed. What kind of seed do fathers carry? So the older girl will explain. He says, you know, it's like this, like that. So why don't they do things like that? He says, no, 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 it's very pleasurable. No, that the ejaculation that takes place. Ooh, it's ecstasy. Say, yes, See, now you're training her into immorality. Your child, your 12-year-old sister, or your daughter, she's being trained. Now I'm asking this story, what is the moral of the story? What is the moral behind that story? What lessons does your sister learn or your daughter learn from that?
That this is life.
That they're cohabiting with the father.
That this happened.
No, no.
This is life. No, no.
You
this
see,
happens.
No, no.
But there is sin in this world.
Yes.
And that people do sin.
No, no. When you tell a story, you see in South Africa, your books of pornography are banned. What I can buy from Kennedy Airport in America, I've been to America, and from Heathrow, if I take it to South Africa, and if they catch me with it, I go to jail for 2 years. But he said, this is it's life, man, life. This is what's happening all the time. He said, you don't bring this into the country, you're going to pollute people's minds. Books of pornography. Jimmy Swaggart has written a book on pornography. And he tells you the dangers of this type of literature. You wouldn't like me to present your sister or your daughter with a book, you know, of pornography, would you? Would you?
Certainly not.
Right. So, in other words, why? But it's a fact of life. It's going on every day, you know?
Because this is a fallen world, yes.
Right. But now, you said, no, you don't give this to my sister or my daughter, even to your wife. If I came to your house in your absence or in your presence, and I started showing her, you know, pornographic pictures, you're going to go berserk. You know, you have every right to throw me out. Am I right? If I try to show your mother?
Yes, very much
sister,
so.
Right? So well, now,
I do not allow that in my house to this day.
Beautiful. That means you have your, still the morals are still there. Yes. But now in a book of God, you're describing the situation night after night, the daughter seducing the father. And they get bastard children being begotten. And these bastard children are blessed in that book. The Ammonites and the Moabites, when the Jews came out of Egypt, they were told to kill the Palestinians, men, women and children. Not even animals were to be spared. Nothing that breathes must live, they were told. But the Ammonites and the Moabites shall not touch because they are the children of Lot, having cohabited with his daughters. What's the moral? What is the moral of that story? What lesson do you learn to your benefit? Dr. Vernon Jones, an American psychologist of great repute, he carried out experiments on groups of school children to whom certain stories may be read. And he said that these stories made certain slight but permanent changes in character, even in the narrow classroom situation, whatever you tell the children of a certain age group. Same age group, you tell them a different type of stories, and these stories have permanent effect on people's characters. They do. You read this? In my country, there were a couple of white guys caught for cohabiting with their daughters. And they said, well, it was written in the Bible, and we thought there's nothing wrong with it. Because God did not reprimand Lot. He didn't give him AIDS or syphilis or gonorrhea. Nothing happened. No reprimand. Nothing. So it means it is accepted. Then we go a step further. Genesis, still Genesis, chapter 35, verse 22.
I'm not sure I agree with your conclusion.
No, no. Just, sorry, I just
don't agree.
Genesis
here.
Chapter 35, verse 22. 35:22. It speaks about Reuben, the eldest son of Jacob. He goes and sleeps with his father's wife, means has sex with her.
I understand what that means. Yeah.
Right. Because your sister would understand, sleep with her, so I'll be warming her bed, because she must be old. I said, no, he went and had sex with her, and Israel heard it. They told Israel, Jacob, that look, your son cohabited with this with your wife, that's his mother. And no reaction. You know, there's no reaction. There's no more context than Jacob had so many sons, and through this one and that one and that one, all his sons are listed. But the verse 22 starts at when Israel, when Jacob dwelt in that land, Reuben, his eldest son, came in and slept with Bilhah, his father's concubine, and Israel heard it. Finish. Close the book. What's the moral? Son cohabiting with his mother. What's the moral of that?
Again, to reveal to mankind that there is sin in the world. And these are the evidences of the types of sin that are committed in the world. Okay, and also shows the shortcomings of mankind. And in showing the shortcomings of mankind, that they are indeed in need of cleansing from their perverted ways.
Does it say that?
Okay. He said, throughout the word, it does.
Now you read Lot cohabiting with his daughters. Is there a single word saying that this is not to be done?
Ammon and Moab was not blessed. Okay. They did reap of the wrath of God because of the sins of the fathers. Yes.
Were the Jews not told that kill the Palestinians, men, women, and children, but the Ammonites and the Moabites thou shalt not touch?
Oh, in there were situations, yes, but they also, though.
No, look, listen. Listen carefully. What is it? Why? Because they are the children of Lot. Mm-hmm. Him cohabiting with his daughters. Those bastard children are more blessed than the Palestinians. So they are a blessed people compared to the Palestinians. That's a book, that's a lesson. Reuben goes and cohabits with his mother, and not a single word of reprimand. Even the father didn't react. Look, man, your grandfather, 80-year-old, if somebody told him that his son, your father, had cohabited with one of his wives, with his mother, he's going to blow his tops. You know that? If he's even paralyzed on one side, he's going to blow his tops and he might have a heart attack. That's human nature. But Israel, he didn't even react. Not one word. He didn't reprimand his son. He didn't give him a slap. He said, you bloody rascal, what the hell you are? What do you do to your cohabit with your mother? There are so many whores in the world, prostitutes. Damn it all, you leave them and you go and sleep with my wife, with your mother. Not one word. Then still Genesis. Don't go out. The types and types of incest. Look, this is a textbook on incest. The types that you can commit. One second. Chapter 38. Speaks about Judah, the father of the Jewish race. He's going to Timnah to share his sheep. Chapter 38, verse 15. Chapter 38, verse 15. Judah, the father of the Jewish race, is going to Timnah to share his sheep. On the way, he sees a woman sitting by the roadside. He thinks she's a harlot.
Yes.
A whore.
Yes.
The hooker.
Yes.
So he comes up to her and says, allow me to come in unto thee, and let me have sex with you.
Yes.
So she said, what will thou give me? He said, I'll give you a kid from the flock, a goat kid.
Yes.
He said, what guarantee that I will give it? You know, you enjoy sex, and you go away, and you don't send the kid, then I lost out. He said, I want some guarantee, pledge. He said, what pledge do you want? He said, your signet, your ring, and your bracelet.
Yeah,
they used to wear bangles those days. And your rod that he was holding in his hand.
Correct.
So the old man gave it to her, and he cohabited with his daughter-in-law, and immediately he made her pregnant. Twins in her womb.
Yes, that's correct.
Right? And these twins, the details that is given how they were born. You know, one puts out his hand through his mother's hole, and the nurse ties a scarlet thread. That's as it's all written there.
Yes.
Right? And that guy pulls his hand back inside, and then comes out the other guy. So she calls his name Fares. Fares means the guy who breaks the queue, who pushes people aside. And then came out his brother with a scarlet thread called Zara, because Zara means red in Hebrew. Zara means red in Hebrew, because he had the scarlet thread. And these two, children of incest, bastard children, they became the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus Christ.
That's correct.
They are the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus. So I'm asking, what is the moral you learn? Children of incest, bastard children of the highest order, you go and commit adultery with somebody else's wife or daughter, that's adultery. Mm-hmm. But incest is worse than that. This guy committed incest with his daughter-in-law, and the bastard children become the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus Christ, of their God, because you don't believe that he's God, of your Christian God, Jesus. Am I correct?
Yes.
Right. What is the moral of that?
I see a couple of purposes there.
Yes.
Number one, when they tried to have a relationship with the father and two daughters, their purpose was to maintain the seed, and seems during that time, maintaining the seed of that family was the most important thing. But going back to what you say, you cannot, just because somebody makes a sin, you cannot blame everybody else. And number three is that he wasn't aware of what was going on because he was drunk, and the two ladies did. So you cannot pass a sin to everybody. You should stop it right there.
Right. But now, if you have done something wrong in your army, you make one mistake, you're called up. Am I right?
But that's me.
Yes. Any soldier, not you only. Every soldier, left, right. You're out of step, you pull up. Am I right? In your army, your training. Anything you do that's out of line, straight away you're pulled up. They don't wait for 6 months and a year, says, you know, I failed you because, you know, certain time you were out of step, certain time when I told you eyes right, you did eyes left. Don't do silly things like that in any reasonable man. You do a thing wrong, straight away you are reprimanded. Say, what are you doing? This is not right. Pull up your socks. You didn't, you know, brush your hair. Whatever it is, you are pulled up straight away. Here is a man begetting bastard children. He didn't remain drunk all his life. They were pregnant and they must have carried the babies and they must have seen, but not one word. Not one word of reproach. Am I correct? There's not one word of reproach in that book. God didn't punish him.
Oh.
Did he? Did he punish Lot? Did he punish Lot?
No.
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 Were the daughters punished?
No.
No.
But but let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Right now, we're trying to point out, okay, wrongness in the Word of God. Okay. And you call it filth.
On the highest order.
That's fine. And your suggestion is that any person that would read this, their minds will become corrupted.
Right.
Okay. Now, my question to you is, obviously, those kinds of words, those kinds of tales are not in the Quran.
That's correct. Very good.
Right.
Not one word.
So therefore, one who reads the Quran, they cannot become corrupted, correct?
Not with that.
I guess my question is then, are you saying then to me, because you are learned in the Quran and you study the Quran, that no man, no woman commits these filthy acts in Islam?
No, I didn't say that.
How did they become corrupted?
Right. Now, they become corrupt by their own inclinations.
That's right.
Right. But exactly. Now.
And all this being revealed in the Word of God is, in fact, man's inclinations to sin.
No, wait. You see, when you are doing something wrong.
Go ahead.
You are making mistakes in your army, your training. And your commander, he doesn't correct you. In other words, now, that becomes an example for the rest. They said, no, anything you can do, you can walk anyhow, you know, as long as you reach your destination. So your commander, your sergeant or whoever it is, immediately he pulls you up and everybody is on your toes.
See, but I don't agree with you when you say that they were not reprimanded, because still see the state of man's, you know, filthiness even in 1993.
Yes,
okay.
Right.
And the wrath of God still is upon mankind,
right.
because of their inclinations to sin. Okay, and here we've transcended many a generations, and we are still a filthy and sinful being. Okay,
right.
But thanks to Jesus Christ, okay, who indeed has been crucified and risen again.
Amen.
For our sins.
Amen.
Okay, because if it had not been for Jesus Christ, God would have just smite this, all this populated world. But Jesus Christ had died for all mankind. Now, my question to you would be then, since, okay, you have been, you know, conveyed to me that indeed in Islam, that they are inclined to sin.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Then the wages of sin is death.
Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
Okay. Uh-huh. The wages of, so is that uh-huh. it for a Muslim? Uh-huh. Because soon as, I can tell you, I don't think there's one in this room that has not sinned.
Right.
And the wages of sin is death.
Yes, it is.
Right. Okay.
Right.
So.
Right.
Is that it for us then?
But now, is there such a thing as forgiveness in the sight of God? Does he forgive?
Oh, he has forgiven.
Yes,
yes, he has forgiven.
Does he forgive?
He has forgiven.
So
through
now,
the Son,
now,
Jesus Christ,
let's,
yes.
Let's get that.
Go.
Blow up one.
Okay.
Now, you say that these examples.
Examples.
Does it happen in the house of Islam?
Yes.
I say it does happen.
Yes, of course.
We are not angels walking this earth.
No, we're not.
We are human beings. But now, to what degree? You see, there are nations and nations. You have 25 million sodomites.
I don't agree with that number, by the way.
Well, you said 20 million. Okay.
No.
I said 20 million. Statistics don't matter. I'm going to ask you a question, then. If we're talking back and forth, are there not sodomites in?
Yes.
Of course there is.
But now, we say now, look at it. The crimes that are committed in Washington, D.C.
Oh, sure.
Yes.
In a week.
Oh, sure.
Murders, rapes, robberies.
Sure.
That number of murder, rapes, and robberies do not happen in Saudi Arabia in a year.
Oh, I understand.
Probably not.
In a year.
I understand.
So now, you see that there's a difference. The type of programming you go through. You read this type of book, incest in America has reached an endemic proportion. Incest people cohabiting with their own daughter.
No, I understand that.
Like, has reached endemic.
Moral degeneracy is what we have in America.
Right.
And so not only in America, but around the world.
No, on a percentage basis, when you have 25 million sodomites in a nation of 250 million, you know, that percentage is stupendous.
I think the figure just recently.
Then you have 7 million, what they call gambling, addicted.
Mm-hmm.
Guys addicted to gambling.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just gamblers taking a chance. But
sure.
They are addicted like drug,
sure.
Like alcohol.
Sure.
7 million of that.
Sure. Now,
you have problems which are unique.
Oh.
And you have a unique nation of born-again Christians.
Oh.
According to Billy Graham.
Many fallen away Christians.
No, no, no.
Okay.
According to Billy Graham, there are 75 million born-again Christians in America.
Okay.
These born-again Christians, I take it you are also one of them.
I am.
Yes, I am. Praise God.
With that amount of born-again Christians, means they are angelic. They don't sin.
No. It's not
good. No. Supposed to be. You're supposed to be paragon of virtue.
You're supposed to repent.
Otherwise, between you and the other guy, there's no difference.
You're supposed to repent.
You say you are born again.
Yeah.
In other words, you are more moral standards.
No, I recognize my sinful nature and my need of a savior.
Right. But now the fact is that you don't sin like as much as the other guy. You won't be committing incest with your daughters. You won't be cohabiting with your sister.
By the grace of God.
You won't be raping your sister. You.
By the grace of God.
Right. So now the thing is, you have a tendency to be on a straighter path than the other guy who's not born again.
But there is
am I correct? Those who are not born again, who don't care, who go to church once in a while,
mm-hmm.
is quite on a different level than you, because you have a constant reminder about God's law.
And the constant reminder is that third person of the Holy Trinity, the Holy Spirit, who dwells in my heart.
Right.
Which is a big difference. That's another one of the significant differences.
Right. So now you have the Spirit of God in you.
That's correct.
Now, does it fill you up, or is there any nooks and corners left in your body where the devil can get in? Your spirit. You have the spirit fills you up. This is what the born again tells me, that you are filled with the spirit. You heard that before?
As I use the Holy Spirit's influence.
That
in my life.
The spirit is filling you up.
But understand, the spirit doesn't fill you up unless you are obedient.
No. So you are, has it filled you up?
Okay.
Has it filled you up?
But it requires obedience. Yes.
But has it filled you up?
Yes, through obedience.
Yes.
In the
Word of God.
Yes, it has. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So now, once the Spirit has filled you up, there is no place for the devil. You see, if this bottle is filled with water, you can't fill up another pint of water inside. Am I correct?
No, you cannot.
Right. If the Spirit fills me, there is no room for the devil to get in.
I hope he does.
But this is how.
Hmm? But if it fills you.
If you understand how to work it, the devil works, don't. For the devil,
he tempts. Are you filled in with the Spirit?
Yes.
The Holy Spirit.
So if you are filled with the Spirit, there is no room for the devil.
That's right.
That's right.
To come into my physical.
If you are filled,
that's right.
If the Spirit fills you, there's no room for the
devil. As long as we continue to abide in the whole armor of God.
Right.
Yes.
Wait a minute. If the Spirit fills you. If the devil can't get in through to you, then he can't tempt you.
Oh, he can tempt you.
He can tempt you.
No, that means that the Spirit is not in you.
Yes,
he can tempt you.
The Spirit
so
is not
are
in
you. Saying,
no.
Are you saying that a man cannot be tempted? Well, let me ask
no,
you
no,
something.
No.
Wait a
minute. I can be tempted.
Let me ask you something. Okay, but we believe Jesus Christ was filled, right? Do you believe Jesus Christ was filled?
No. Because he was tempted by the devil. The devil tempted him. That means they had scope. You see, he gave himself a scope for the devil to get through to him. That if the devil can take
the devil can take you for a ride. But he did not overcome him, did he? The devil did not overcome Jesus, did he?
The fact is that you allowed yourself to be carried by the devil.
Hallelujah.
If the devil carried you, if the devil can carry you for a moment, that means for that moment you fell. For that moment you are fallen. If the devil carries you, you allow himself to carry you to the top of the high mountain and show you the kingdoms of the world and tell you, the devil tells you, that if you worship me, I'll give you all this.
And we are to resist.
No, no, wait.
Yes,
sir. He says, I will give you all this.
Right.
Now, he is supposed to be God. All those things are supposed to belong to him. Am I right? All the kingdoms of the world are supposed to belong to Jesus.
Of the world, yes.
Yes. And this devil is offering him your things. Like me offering to you, I said, look man, if you worship me, that Bible you have in hand, I'll give it to you. He said, Uncle, there's something wrong with you. I said, you know, if you worship me, John, I said, the specs, your specs, I'll give them to you. He said, Uncle, I think you are not right in your head. Am I right? Because that belongs to you. How can I give you that? If I promise you something else, I'll give you my specs, then it might mean something. But your own property I'm offering it to you is the most nonsensical thing. Unless you say, I'm a loony, and you are a loony to accept it. You must be a loony to accept that. I said, your specs I'll give them to you as a reward for worshipping me. So the man allowed himself, according to your book, to be tempted. And the Christians say that the Spirit is filling them, and I can see that it has not helped the Americas, because the Bible says, a little leaven leaveneth the whole. You need just need a little yeast to ferment the loaf.
That's right.
But if you have one third of yeast in a 2-pound loaf, one third of it is yeast, and if it does not ferment the loaf, there's something wrong with your yeast, or there's something wrong with your flour. There's something wrong with your yeast.
Mm-hmm.
That means what you're talking about is all nonsense. All these guys who have been born again, your evangelists.
Yes.
They one by one, the whole bang lot of them, 100% they have been falling. 100%. Jimmy Swaggart, mm-hmm. You know what he did. Mm-hmm. Jim Baker, mm-hmm. Born again Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Martin Gorman, Reverend.
But understand, and the word also says that, but many that says unto me, Lord, Lord. Okay.
That is speaking about you. That verse refers to you.
Almost definitely.
Yes,
and
yes.
To the Jim Bakers of the world, to the Jim Bakers of the world.
That doesn't refer to that. It refers to you on the day of judgment. When Jesus in the second coming, when he comes along, and you're going to say, Lord, Lord.
Haven't
I? Did we not prophesy in thy name?
That's right.
Mm.
And in thy name cast out devils.
That's right.
And in thy name do many mighty works.
Yeah.
What you're doing now. Jesus says, then will I profess unto them,
I know you not.
I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity.
That's right.
In the Bible, it says, foot sack, get away, your rubbish, your garbage, I don't even know you.
Yes.
So now I'm asking you, seem to be a very clever man, I'm asking you, when you, on the day of judgment, when you rush to him and say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in thy name, in the name of Jesus? And in thy name cast out devils. And in thy name do many mighty works. And he's going to tell you, foot sack, you bloody rubbish, I don't even know you. Foot sack, get away. So I'm asking you, do the Jews, will they say, Lord, Lord to Jesus?
Understand, no, they will not.
Will the Muslims say, Lord, Lord to Jesus?
No, they will not.
Who will say, Lord, Lord to Jesus? You. You are that guy. You.
Yes.
You say, Lord, Lord.
Yes,
and he
will.
And he will tell you, foot sack, get away from me, you garbage. I don't even know you.
No, mm-hmm.
You're
not
saying that. Read it. Matthew chapter 7.
Oh, yeah, that's it. Says it to those who will call upon his name.
Right.
There are many others that are calling upon. But there are many others that are calling upon his name, because even Islam, Muslims call upon the Lord.
Nobody does.
If you call,
that's a lie.
You call him Allah.
Who is Allah?
Your God.
Who is Allah?
Your God.
God Almighty.
Okay.
That's God Almighty.
Okay.
Right.
But I'm just saying.
And that's his name.
I'm saying, but
no,
understand.
this is the point. There are many that are calling upon
God.
Not Jesus. Not Jesus. This is your God. Jesus. You're calling your Jesus Lord.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Now, because the very fact, you call your Jesus Lord, and because he is not Lord, therefore he says, foot sad, get away from me, you rubbish. I don't even know you, because I'm not your Lord. The Lord is God, the Father in heaven. The Father in heaven, he is Lord. He is God. Not me. Since you have made him into a Lord, therefore he says, foot sack, you get away. All these miracles you have worked is rubbish, garbage. So, this hallelujah. Say hallelujah. He said a number of times. You heard that hallelujah?
Yes.
Yes, I did.
Now I'm asking, what is hallelujah?
It's a praise.
What does it mean?
It's a praise.
No, what does it mean?
Praise Jehovah.
Do you hear the words? Hallelujah. Allah, Allah. You hear the word Allah? Hallelujah. Oh, Hallelujah. Ya Allahu. This is his name. You see, in the genius of the languages, your Western languages, the genius of your language is that you use an exclamation mark at the end. You say, fire! You know, in the mouth, you say, fire. If it's written down, you write F-I-R-E, fire and exclamation mark. Say, stop! You say, S-T-O-P, stop, exclamation mark. That's the genius of your language. In Hebrew and Arabic, we begin with an exclamation. We say, Ya Akhi, oh, Ya, oh my brother. Ya Ummi, oh my mother. Ya Allah, oh Allah. We begin with Ya, you end with Ya, exclamation. So, Alleluia is Ya Allahu, Ya Allahu, Ya Allahu, Ya Allahu. That is what we are saying. Actually, every time you take the word, you're taking the name of Allah. Because Alleluia doesn't sound like Jehovah. It doesn't sound like Abba. Jesus on the cross is supposed to have cried out with a loud voice. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani.
Yes.
And I'm asking the Jehovah's Witness. Does that sound to you like Jehovah, Jehovah, lama sabachthani? Does it? You are a Jehovah's Witness?
No, I study with Jehovah's.
Are you?
I have no basic religion.
No, you've got that Bible of the Jehovah's Witnesses, which means you accept that Bible as more authentic than that what these guys are carrying.
Yes, I do.
Right. So now they tell you the name of God is Jehovah.
Jehovah.
Have you heard that before?
Yes. Yahweh.
That's what they say.
Yahweh or Jehovah.
They say Jehovah, Jehovah's Witnesses.
Or the other one, they say Jehovah too.
They say they are Jehovah's Witnesses. They don't say Yahweh's Witnesses. They say Jehovah's Witnesses. So, I'm asking them, when Jesus cried, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, to you, the Jehovah's Witness, I say, does that sound to you like Jehovah, Jehovah, lama sabachthani? No. Unless your ear is diseased.
No, it's sort of.
Right. Does that sound to you like Abba? Abba, lama sabachthani? Abba means father.
Abba means father.
Does that sound like that? No. Now listen.
Eli.
Eli. Eli. Eli. Eli. Eli. Lama sabachthani in Hebrew. Allah. Allah. Lama taratani in Arabic. Eli. Eli. Lama sabachthani. Allah. Allah. Lama taratani. Sound similar? Arabic and Hebrew? Sound similar?
Yes.
So, who is he crying to? He's not crying to Jehovah, Jehovah, or my father, Abba, Abba. He's counting to Allah. Allah in the Hebrew language. In the Hebrew language, this is what it sounds. You see, in Arabic, this is what it sounds. It's Arabic and Hebrew are sister languages. They are almost identical. So when you say Alleluia, it's actually Yallahu, Yallahu, Yah. Congratulations to you. At least you have not forgotten his name. You have not yet forgotten his name. In your Bible, it's there. In the book of Revelation, chapter 19. Alleluia. Is there. Ella Ella is there. Mm-hmm. But the word Jehovah is not there. Did you know that? In the 27 books of the New Testament, not once did the word Jehovah occur.
No, it's
not. Right. So that means that, look, who is responsible for those manuscripts? If God Almighty is the inspirer of those 27 books, then is he ashamed of his own name? That's what it means, it implies. He's ashamed of his own name. He doesn't want his name to be recorded at all. In the 27 books, not once did the word Jehovah occur. Did you know that?
Yes.
Yes. So that means that, where did you concoct this from? How did you concoct this? You see, the Christian now is making religion out of Hallelujah. He's making out of baptism, you know. I don't know whether you're a Baptist or whatever you are.
I'm a Christian.
Of, what Christian?
I'm
what
a
church?
Christian.
What church you belong to?
I'm a Christian.
Yeah, what church?
I'm not to the church.
I'm a Seventh Day Adventist.
Mrs. Ellen G. White.
Do you know anything about Seventh Day?
Oh yes, Mrs. Ellen G. White. You know your prophetess. I have read her The Great Controversy.
Yes.
And I got her quotation about the Bible, how the Bible came about.
Yeah.
How people, you know, they use change the words.
I'll give it to you now.
He'll give it to me just now. Mrs. Ellen G. White, what he has to say about your Bible. This one you're carrying now, the King James Version. So what she says, Mrs.
Inspired,
Ellen G. White,
in her
inspired commentary, mm-hmm. what she says about the Bible writers, that how they change words and they change expressions, trying to make things clear. What was clear, they made it ambiguous. All this what has been there.
But that happens with the Quran also. When you translate the Quran in English or in Spanish, you suffer from translation.
Right.
That's exactly what happened to the
writing. Agree.
But now, no
Muslim will tell you that the translation is the word of God.
But wait a minute. Let's go back to...
Jehovah's Witnesses don't say the same thing. They say the same thing.
Wait a minute. You say...
They call this the Bible. They call this the New Words translation.
Let's go back to what the prophets have revealed.
Let's see, Mrs. Ellen G. White,
yeah.
Since you say you are a Seventh-day Adventist,
I am.
You know, it makes some interesting reading. Right. Mrs. Ellen G. White. Ellen G. White, a prophetess of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, in her Bible commentary, volume 1, page 14, has this confession to make about the fallibility of the Holy Bible. She says, now I'm quoting her, "The Bible we read today is the work of many copyists who have, in most instances, done their work with marvelous accuracy." Most instances, not all. They have done their work with marvelous accuracy. "But copyists have not been infallible. And God most evidently has not seen fit to preserve them altogether from error." God did not see fit. That means he didn't care a damn whether you did any damn thing of your own, which you have been doing to the Bible. You have been adding and deleting from the Bible words. Even now, there you see there. That means the continuous sickness is carrying on. Now with the Quran, that is not so. The Arabic Quran is there throughout the world. There is not a difference of an iota difference between one Quran and another. I don't know whether you know that. In the translation, you have a choice of words. I have no objections to that. You have a choice of words. King James Version, this version, that version. I have no objection to that. But when you take out chunks and chunks, like the Roman Catholic Bible, if you don't, it's got 73 books.
I don't subscribe to it either. 73 books of the
Roman Catholic Bible.
Sure.
Which seven now you have expunged from yours, saying that those seven are apocrypha. Doubtful. And I agree with you.
Okay.
I agree with you. But now the Roman Catholics say they outnumber you.
It's okay.
Right.
Yeah.
They say this is the word of God per se.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You say no, there are seven books there which are fabrication. Mm-hmm. Now you say this is the word of God. You, the Protestants, the Seventh-day Adventists, and whoever this guy is.
I'm a Christian.
No, right. Whatever type of Christian, if you hold this book as the word of God, then it says now, your revisers, your Christian revisers, scholars, they say they have grave defects. And they are so many and so serious as to call for revision. Are they honest people or are they thieves, these people? 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they are condemning this book of yours, the one we are holding, as with grave defects. And those defects, now they start taking it out. Now, let's forget that for a while.
I know in whom I believe.
You see, this book, the Bible, the concept of God that's given in your book.
Yes.
Any religion you want to evaluate, you must find out what is the concept of God. If you think God is like a man or a monkey or an elephant or a snake, that is the level of your religion. If you think your God is a monkey or a donkey, that is the level of your intelligence and the level of your religion. It's your concept of God. What do you think of God? What is he like?
He's omnipotent.
Yes.
He's omniscient.
Beautiful.
All-knowing.
What else?
All-knowing.
What else?
God of love.
Right.
A holy God.
Right. So also, this is God of yours in your Bible now. It tells us that he is a hissing God. He hisses like a snake. Do you know that?
Your God is
open your Bible. Open your Bible, Isaiah chapter 5, verse 26.
Because I like to read the word.
It's a hissing God.
Isaiah?
Chapter 5, verse 26. He hisses like a snake, your God. Read it loud. Unless yours is different, change now. 5:26. Mine says he hisses like a snake. Read it.
26?
Yes.
And he will lift up an ensign to the nations from afar.
No, I don't hear that. I didn't hear that word. And he will?
And he will lift up an ensign.
Ensign.
What ensign? How do you spell it?
ENSIGN,
an
ensign.
What chapter is that?
The fifth chapter.
It changed it again. That's bad. What does your Bible say here?
Which one are we? You want to choose?
You're 7 Adventists. 5:26.
5:26. And he will lift up an ensign.
And he will lift up an ensign to the nations from afar. And will hiss unto them. From the end of the earth. Behold, they shall come with speed swiftly.
Hiss.
None shall be weary nor stumble among them. None shall slumber nor sleep. Neither shall the girdle of their loins
be loosed, nor
the latchet of their shoes be broken.
The word of the prophet, yes.
Whose arrows are sharp, and all their bows bent, their horses' hoofs shall be counted like flint, and their wheels like a whirlwind. Their roaring shall be like a lion. They shall roar like young lions.
He shall roar like a lion.
And shall carry it away safe, and none shall deliver it.
Lovely.
And in that day they shall roar against them like the roaring of the sea. And if one look unto the land, behold darkness and sorrow, and the light is darkened in the heavens thereof.
Right. So now he hisses like a snake, and he roars like a lion, and now he cuts hair like a barber. You know hair barber? I said, don't go far. Chapter 7, verse 20. Chapter 7, verse 20. He cuts people's hairs with a hired razor, your God.
7:20
of Isaiah. You read it in the New World Translation. Let us hear what it says.
Mine is in Spanish. You will understand.
Spanish.
I don't understand Spanish.
No, Spanish. Let me hear you. You read quite beautifully. Articulate.
Thank you.
You really have good articulation. Yes. 26. I'm sorry.
Isaiah chapter 7, verse 20. In the same day shall the Lord shave with a razor that is hired. Namely,
Lord, this Lord is Jesus Christ or God?
By them beyond the
brother,
river.
Brother.
Yes,
this
yes,
Lord
friend.
Is God. Is Lord, when you say Lord, is in your Bible, is it God? Or is it some teacher or somebody like that?
God, Jesus, right. One and the same.
Right. So this is God Almighty. With a hired razor, he is going to shave, yes, go ahead.
By them beyond the river, by the king of Assyria, the head, and the hair of the feet, and it shall also consume the beard.
Right.
And it shall come to pass in that day that a man shall nourish a young cow and two sheep. And it shall come to pass for the abundance of milk that they shall give, he shall eat butter. For butter and honey shall everyone eat that is left in the land. And it shall come to pass in that day that every place shall be, where there were 1,000 vines and 1,000 silverlings,
it shall even be for briar and thorns. All that is not necessary. The thing I want to draw your attention to is that he will shave the hair on your heads and your beards and the hair on your legs. Who? God Almighty, your God, he is working as a barber now.
You're not a barber.
A barber God. Your God becomes a barber with a hired razor. He hasn't got a razor of his own even.
Well,
explain that. I want you to explain that.
Well, for one thing.
God shaves your hair.
Wait a minute.
Of your head
if
and your
I
beard.
Speak, Uncle.
I want to ask you.
I respect your age.
Thank you.
Your wisdom.
Thank you.
But
I'm asking you.
Please speak.
I want you to explain.
Let's
if you can,
speak.
What does it mean?
First of all, the Word of God is, there's many symbologies that are used in the Word. There are many parables that are taught in the Word, okay? See, unless one be of the Spirit of God.
Yeah.
They cannot understand the symbologies.
Now
they don't,
You got the Spirit.
Now
You got the Spirit.
I pray for God's wisdom all the time.
Right. So now you can understand.
Because no man can even come close to the wisdom of God.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
And even our worldly wisdom.
That's right.
Doesn't even come close. You know, to the wisdom of God.
Amen.
There may be many of us that walk this land that may appear to be wise, but our wisdom is nothing but vanity, because that's what the Word of God says.
Yes,
so
amen.
No, I can't say that I can explain to you every parable, every symbology that is used in the Word of God. No. And that's okay. I don't need to.
Amen.
But I believe in the God. I believe in an all-wise God.
I believe in an omnipotent God.
Yes.
I believe in an omniscient God.
Yes.
And I believe a God that will not lead us astray.
Yes.
Now,
will not lead us astray.
You say God is omnipotent.
Yes.
He is all powerful.
No, he's all powerful.
All powerful.
He can do what he pleases.
He is all powerful.
Can he do everything?
He cannot lie.
But now, can he do anything? He can conquer people, nations.
He can overcome. If he wants to.
Right. And if he fails because of your heavy armored cars and tanks, if he tells you that, look, I couldn't prevail against the Americans because of the super armaments. For example.
You see? What? Like
he was supposed to help us, you know, God Almighty, for example. But now, God himself, he failed to prevail against the Americans because they had laser guns and they had, you know, super tanks. Now, in that case, we know he's not omnipotent.
Whoa.
And if that is the situation, that we say God is on our side and God is going to help us and God tells us, I will help you. But in the end, God failed us. And the reason given in your book is that because the opposition had stronger armaments, then we'll say, look, this God is not omnipotent.
God is omnipotent.
So now you have a little patience. I show you.
Please.
I show you. Mark chapter 10, verse 27. Also Matthew chapter 19, verse 26. For God, now you don't have to check that because he says, with God all things are possible. You must have read that before.
Oh, yes.
With God all things are possible.
Yes.
You don't have to go and check up now.
No. Yeah.
If you want to, you may.
No, go ahead. Finish reading.
Right.
Please.
Right. So we accept that statement. We say, with God all things are possible. Now, Judges chapter 1 verse 19, that you can open, which contradicts that. Book of Judges, chapter 1 verse 19. Book of Judges chapter 1 verse 19. You got it, brother? I see you got it pretty fast.
I'm there.
Yes, 7 days. You're pretty blessed. I would like to hear you read that.
Oh, it says, and the Lord was with Judah,
uh-huh.
and he drave out the inhabitants of the mountain,
uh-huh.
but could not drive out the inhabitants of the valley because they had chariots of iron.
Right. There it is. So God couldn't do it. He drove out the inhabitants of the mountains,
mm-hmm.
but the inhabitants of the valley, God couldn't, because they had chariots of iron, they had armored cars, tanks. See, so they got failed. How will you explain that? It's a parable. What blooming parable is that? What is a parable about that? And God failed because they have chariots. It's telling you because they have chariots of iron. They have armored cars, tanks. They have tanks. You said he can do anything. But he can't if you've got armored cars and tanks on your side. You know, the Somalis, they can't prevail against the Americans because the Americans have got helicopter gunships.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, you can say the Lord was with the Somalis, but then the God failed. But if your book says the God failed because of the American having, you know.
I don't read that as saying the Lord failed.
What does it say?
It says, and the Lord was with Judah.
Right, that means he was helping him. That means he was helping Judah.
The Lord was with Judah.
Uh-huh.
And he drave out the inhabitants.
Right,
Judah.
Right.
Drave out the inhabitants.
Who God? God did all that.
Judah.
Yeah. No? And
Judah.
He. All right. So he was with Judah. With the help of God.
And the Lord was with Judah.
Right.
And he drave out the inhabitants of the mountains. But Judah, now understand something. See, that didn't say that the Lord failed. The Lord was with Judah.
Right.
Now,
if it was not
God's will for Judah to drive out the inhabitants of the chariots of iron.
What did the Lord do? Did he say, tell Judas, look man, it is not my will that you drive out the inhabitants of the valley. Did he say that?
So no. If you Americans
are with Israel, mm-hmm. you know, you're helping like your illegitimate mm-hmm. son.
Okay.
Your illegitimate child of America, Israel, is your child, you know, your ill-begotten son. Now, you are visiting Israel. You see, at every turn, when the Muslims, the Arabs, when they go to war against Israel, it is America who's fighting us. In 1973, when Sadat broke the Bartlett line, he crossed into the Sinai, 73.
Yes.
And Israel was got by its throat.
Yes.
And America came in direct intervention through the Azores with men and material in the battle. 1973. I don't know what you were doing then. Maybe schooling. 1973.
Yes,
it
was.
Young man.
Right.
Yeah. Young boy.
1973, the American with the Air Force
yeah. Yeah.
and all the machines and all, they got direct into the battle against the poor Arabs. And the Arabs were beaten once more again. Right. So he says, now you see, that because of America, the Israelis have an upper hand upon us, because of the Americans.
Okay.
Same thing now, you were with Israelis. But now if you fail, we say the Americans failed. The Americans failed, the Jews. Because you are with them, they are like your own illegitimate son. But now, once you fail, we say now the Americans failed.
Mm-hmm.
When Israel is defeated, we say America was defeated.
Like Vietnam.
Huh? That's Vietnam. That means now you Americans were defeated. You see? You can't say the South Vietnam.
Okay, so you're saying God failed.
Right. Well, so God if God is with you, and he helped you to defeat one, but he didn't help you to defeat the other, that means God failed you.
It may not have been his express will for that.
That's what the book says. That's what your book
says.
And
it says that...
On the very face of it.
It says that, but could not drive out the inhabitants.
Could not drive out. Could not drive out.
Chariots of iron.
Right, because, why? Because they're chariots of iron. The easy meat was easy meat for you. But if the opposition has got also the atom bomb, like the Russians, then you can't defeat them. That's what it means. Then he said, now look, God failed you. If God is with you, and if he lets you down against the Russians, then we say that God failed you. God failed you. Right. Then you are told here that you said he's a merciful God.
Yes, he
God
is.
God is a merciful God. He's compassionate.
Yes, he is.
God Almighty, this God of mercy, yours in the Bible, he tells people not to look into the ark. And 50,070 persons looked into the ark, and they were all killed. How many? 50,070 people were killed for looking into a box. That's mercy. In your army, if your commander tells you, if your commander tells you that any of you disobey me, you'll be court-martialed. Now, the right type of commander, the just commander, is the first guy who makes that mistake, say, hey, John! Sorry, sir, I forgot. Still, if he wants to court-martial you, we can still court-martial you. If he wants to forgive you, we can forgive you. But the first guy who makes a mistake, he pulls him up. Am I right? In your army?
Not always.
Then what? He allows you.
Punishment.
He allows you, and 2, and 10, and 50, and 100, and 1,000, and 50,000, and 70 people to make the same mistake, and then court-martial you all. Is that the work of a loony or of a sane person? Your commander, is he sane or is he a loony? I want to know. If he allows 50,070 Americans, soldiers, to make the same damn mistake, and then court-martial the whole lot, or shoot them all, firing line, all of you,
mm-hmm.
massacre.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a sane guy in charge of the army? Is he sane, according to your thinking?
Ask three questions.
Now, why don't you line up? Why are you sitting there like a dead duck, you know? Why don't you line up there? You get your turn. You. Line up. Take your turn. Then we know who you are, what you're talking about. See, shouting from there. Now he's discussing. He's discussing strategy. However, look, my son. I am like anybody else, like you, like anybody else. I am no saint. And I am not perfect. I am telling you, this is what Islam teaches. I, you, everybody, you must try to the best of your ability to live by it.
let's say to a degree, I have fallen short of that requirement. I have done it. I have done it.
Good man. Thank you. Next, the next questioner, please. Identify yourself.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Omar. I'm a Muslim. I need no other identification except the title that Allah and His infinite wisdom, power, and grace has given to me, and that is that I'm a Muslim. I heard much of what you said, and I agreed, and I heard much of what you said, and I was hurt and disagreed. I was pained for the children that were here and the language. Of course, we live in a world where language such as that is often used. But what pained me the most was when I heard, if I can quote you, and please allow for my inaccuracies, sometimes I am often mistaken. If you live in a country, you should be willing to die for it. Well, there are many countries in which I'm willing to live, but there's certainly only one cause for which I'm willing to die. Please clarify yourself if you could.
Yes. Thank you. You see, I made a statement that if a country is worth living in, it is worth dying for. I did say that. Islam teaches us that if you can't live, you can't practice your religion, you can't do things right, then you make hijrah. Allah tells us in the Quran that His earth is vast. You know, for provision, He will provide for you. Make hijrah and go. Go somewhere else. You have no right to remain. In a place now, if you are not allowed to practice your faith, your iman, our thing is now, if you are not in a position to practice your deen, you must get out. That is all. So, but if it's worth, I say, if it's worth living in, your country is at war and you sit at home and say, let the people die for you, for your children, I says, no, you must be prepared to defend the country against any outside attack. Right is right, wrong is wrong. But you owe certain loyalties to your country. If you're in Pakistan, you have to defend Pakistan. If you're in Saudi Arabia and there's conscription, in my country, there's no conscription for the black man. But if there is, I can't help it. He said, look, if you live in this country, you have to fight for this country. Otherwise, get out. So this is the answer I can give you, my brother. That I said, if it's worth, if you think it's worth living in, then it's worth dying for. If it's not worth living in, then you are free.
Assalamu alaikum. Brother Sheikh, in bracket, Professor Deedat, in your opening speech earlier, you mentioned the course you took in South Africa relating to this satanic sermon. I think I am in full support of what you did, and I am very pleased with the success you got. But will people, say in predominantly Muslim countries, and also Muslims living in this country, follow the same course? Viewing that the book was written here, published here, which means all those actors, the Queen, the head of state, and other leaders who were accused or abused, have read the book, presumably, or some others have read it and translated it to them. They knew it, and yet they allowed it to be published. So if they didn't object to it, we as Muslims living in this country, though I'm not British, but I'm living here, should we not protest to defend our own religion, our own faith, our own belief? May I know what you think about the action of our brothers and sisters in Bradford, who really brought us to light to defend our cause? Thank you.
I think you missed the point when I said that if I was here with you when this turmoil was taking place, I would have joined you in your marches, in your crying, in your book burning. I would have been one with you. Did I say that? If you remember, I said that. I would have been one with you. But now I said I have an advantage. I was far away, and I was taking some time for me to see things. In other words, now I can formulate ideas, which you in the midst of turmoil, sitting on a hot stove, you can't do. It's not your fault. I'm not blaming anybody. They said, look, why couldn't you do this? Why? I said, look, the reason is you were in turmoil. You are on the run, like Jesus Christ. You see it in the Bible. The man is on the move. Every time he opens his mouth, people want to stone him. So he's on the move. It's a different circumstances from another man who is at peace and rest and he's able to deliver a message. So I have that advantage and experience from other people's mistakes. I'm benefiting. I said, look, this man here on the program was questioned. Have you read the book? And our heroes, almost all, they say no. So I said, no, I mustn't fall foul of that. Suppose I go to Britain and I offered £50,000 to BBC TV. BBC TV, I offered them £50,000 to give me 5 minutes on prime time to give them the best of Rushdie. I said, you want to read in public? You had the blasphemous banquet? Give me only 5 minutes and I give you £50,000. Give me 5 minutes to read to you the best of Rushdie. No reply. I offered ABC and PBS TV in America $50,000 for 5 minutes. Give me 5 minutes. Why I'm able to do that is I'm benefiting from my other brother's mistakes. They made certain mistakes. I said, I won't do that. You know, I might just share this with you. I think Sheikh Saadi Rahmatullah Alay, one of our great philosopher poets, he was asked, he says, where did you learn all these good manners from? Your good manners. You know, you're such a perfect man that we see, you know, well behaved. Where did you learn them from? So he said, I learned them from the unmannerly. So how can you learn manners from the unmannerly? He said, no, you see, everything I see in the other man that I feel is not right, I won't do it. So this thing you did like that, I won't do that. That mistake you did, said, no, I won't do that. So I learned my good manners from the unmannerly. What do you? So I was only benefiting from other people's mistakes. That is all.
Thank you very much. You are great. Next questioner, please. Could you identify yourself, please?
Assalamu alaikum. I have no question, but a request. A request only to Dr. Deedat, what he's doing in this world, to be translate one share which I've researched and invite everybody to come in Speaker Corner. Nikhil Kar Khan Kaun Se, Dr. Iqbal says, Maulana Lolabi Kashmiris, in Kashmir is translated in Urdu. Nikhil Kar Khan Kaun Se.
Sir, could you ask your question?
Ada Kar Rasme Shabiri, Ke Fakre Khan Kai Hai Fakar Andu Wo Dilgiri. Aap Sab Ka Kaam Hai Nikhil Jai Garu Se, Barku Ko, Masjidu Ko, Jahan Koi Ek Sufayad Milta Hai, please translate in English.
I'm not an Urdu Khan, but so few words I understood was that instead of remaining in the monkeries and in your cloisters, you know, saying tasbih and sitting down doing nothing, he said, get out and do some work. That is what he's in essence, that's the message.
Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, Sheikh Ahmed. It's alright us saying, right, to stop Salman Rushdie for what he's done to the brothers and sisters. But don't you think he's done the damage already to us? Don't you think what he's done already is very bad already? So don't you think that if we did see him, her natural reaction would be to do something to him. Wouldn't you think so? For what he's done to us?
You are a Britisher.
Yeah.
Right. Your feelings are my feelings.
Yeah.
Can we have the next questioner, please? Would you identify yourself, please, sir?
Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh. Would, after all the things that that Salman Rushdie did, said, and would he be allowed back into Islam? Would he be allowed to accept Islam again?
You see, accepting Islam, this is in the hands of God, whether Allah accepts. If you commit murder, rape, whatever, you commit a crime. Now, if you make istighfar, repentance sincerely to Allah, Allah can forgive you. But in the house of Islam, the Sharia takes its course. Allah can forgive, but the Sharia won't forgive. You committed a murder, deliberate murder, you deserve to die, life for life. But in the hereafter, your recompense is there. Allah says, all right, okay, you know, you sincerely repented, I forgive you. That's his prerogative. But the Sharia has no right. The Sharia won't allow you to forgive if you do a crime.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. My name is Sayyida Kirmani, and I'm a British Muslim. And this question is to you, Brother Deedat. You mentioned in your course of speech the Islamic punishment for adulterers and slanderers, but you haven't mentioned the punishment which says in the Quran for the blasphemy that Rushdie committed. And as a Muslim, and as far as my knowledge goes of the Quran, your approach to Rushdie affair is in contradiction of Holy Quran. My second question is...
No, that was a statement.
My second question is...
That was not a question, that was a statement you made. What's
do you agree
question?
With this?
What?
Do you agree with my statement?
What statement did you make? What did you say?
In Quran, the punishment for blasphemy against the Prophet of Allah is quite different. It's either by death or by stoning or cutting arms and legs. And that's what it says in Quran. Yes.
Right, I'll answer you, my sister. We were dealing with the subject, how Rushdie fooled the West. Now, this thing I was telling you, this is so vast that this one person or one time you can't deal with everything. I have dealt with this problem. Now, this will be the third tape. Third tape on the same problem. Should Rushdie die? The Islamic verdict.
Should he?
Should, there's the question. But now you have to get the tape.
Can you tell us? Because no, we're all here. No.
This is another lecture. You want me to deliver another lecture?
No, just say
no, no,
a few
no, wait,
words.
wait. We started here at 2:30. It's 4:30 now. This will take another 2 hours. You want me to expound to you for 2 hours? Look,
no.
you can't just make statements. You have to get this tape.
I'm only asking you if you agree with the Quranic punishment
I
or you
agree
don't.
What the Quran says, and here we deal with it in total. 2 hours.
So you agree with the Quranic punishment?
How, as a Muslim, how can you disagree?
That's all I want.
Then further, again, should Rushdie die?
Yes.
The Judeo-Christian verdict. That's a different subject. Now, at that subject, you said, look, what about Islam? I said, look, when I was talking about Islam, you said, what about... I said, look, wait a minute. You see, there are people who can make 100 different statements in 15 minutes. Unfortunately, I can't do that. You see, if I touch something, I have to explain to you the whole situation. So, the Islamic verdict, the Judeo-Christian verdict, and now you will see in the future how he fooled the West. And now each and everyone is separate, independent, but is doing a certain job.
I think that Sheikh Deedat has been very patient in answering a question that is not related to the topic. And brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to ask you to please remain and contain your questions to the topic. It is unfair to ask a question on another topic which will require perhaps a couple hours of explanation. Could we have the next question, please?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Tawassul Mehmed, and I'm a Muslim Pakistani. I want to ask you, is the fatwa passed by Ayatollah Khomeini, is that justified from an Islamic point of view?
I don't think you understand English, my child. Look, we have been talking about how Rushdie fooled the West. Where does Khomeini fit in?
Is it questions
this is the topic. Look, if you came with the understanding, I don't know whether you understood, a challenge to the giants of the British literary world, you know, can you stomach the best of Rushdie? There was no Khomeini, no Quran, nothing. We're not bringing it, the Quran says this, the Hadith says this, nothing. We are talking about how he fooled the West. And what you can do now is to educate the British what he has done to them. Let them do the job, and they will do it for you.
Could we have the next questioner, please?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.
Would you identify yourself, please?
My name is Hajj, and I would like to ask a question to Sheikh Ahmed Deedat. He says that Rushdie has blasphemed all the humankind, all human beings. And even if he didn't spare the Queen, we know, as he says in his book, he has used some words for our Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know that this Prophet is even greater than the Queen, or whoever that is greater than the Queen, the Prophet is greater than you. I would like to know, Mr. Ahmed Deedat, as a Muslim, because something went on and some books have been banned. I would like to know, as a Muslim, our point of view, what should we carry on actually to do? Because many questions, the real question that is to be asked is whether Salman Rushdie is a Muslim or he's not a Muslim.
I don't think you're reading the newspapers. Look, Salman Rushdie, he says he is not a religious man. He doesn't follow any religion. That's his verdict. He is out of the pale of Islam on his own confession. Well, now what do you want to go and ask him now? What will we ask him? He says he doesn't believe. Finish. It's over. That's what he says. He's a murtad. He's an unbeliever. So you can't treat him as a believer. What else proof you want from him now? I don't know, the whole world knows that he says he's not a religious man, he's not a Muslim, he says so. He was born in the house of Islam, you and I can be, but it's possible that you become a murtad, you become a Christian, you become a Buddhist, you become an atheist, and you still have a Muslim name, given by your fathers. So that's his case. So where do you go from here now?
Thank you very much.
Assalam.
Ready for the next question, please?
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Musa from Nigeria on a visit. I wanted to ask a question which has earlier on been asked. But I have an observation to do as regard the general behavior of the audience. I don't know whether that one will be accepted here. Observation.
Do you have a question related to the topic, today's topic?
I have a question which has already been asked and answered. We have an observation to do as regard the general behavior of the audience.
Yes, I think that we made that quite clear in the guidelines that we don't have time for observations, and I'm sure it's an interesting one, but Sheikh Deedat has rented the hall and has given his lecture, and now is a question period. So if you have a question related to the topic, please ask it. If not, you'll have to keep your observation for another time.
It's just an observation. Since not going to
But thank you.
It's accepted, thank you.
We're ready for the next question, please.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muslim Jafar Kaku. Can I first of all thank you on everybody's behalf for presenting such a different way to what Islam, Satanic Verses is actually saying. The second thing I wanted to say was, can you make sure or do some effort in helping us to give this book to each and every household in Britain as well as in America or in Western countries? We will try, inshallah, but we need your support. Can you make sure in helping us, if you can, by video as well?
We are publishing 100,000 in Britain for free distribution, and another 100,000 in America for free distribution. I would like to see 1 million copies here and 1 million copies there. But now, I'm appealing to you that don't kill the goose that lays the golden egg. See, don't kill us. What you do is, how much does this book cost each? Roughly? 15 pence? Right. This costs 15 pence. Buy 10. Buy 100 at 15 pence each, so you don't kill us. And you give them out on your behalf. You know? This is what you ought to do. Sorry. That way you'll be helping us immensely. Because now I'm interested in publishing the 100,000 under print. But then I said, look, I want 1 million. Look, this book should be given out in the streets, in all the cities. Give them out freely. You know, you buy them at cost price. If you can publish them yourself cheaper, we are giving you an open order inside.
We want no royalties from you. We have no copyrights. You publish it, you sell it, you distribute it free. No restrictions whatsoever. So if you want to do that, you can have that privilege as well. You can print it yourself. Maybe it'll cost you 10 pence. Yeah. Maybe it'll cost you 5 pence. Go ahead and do it. But help us that way. Spread the book.
Inshallah, we'll help you. But if you can start a fund or something just to publicize this book and the videos, I'm sure you'll get a lot of response from people Inshallah. Who want to donate to this cause. Inshallah.
No, we don't want donation. You just buy it yourself. If you have got no time, buy 100 copies only. Okay. For how many? 15 pounds.
Thanks very much.
Or something like that.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum, Mr. Deedat.
Yes, if we could have two more questions, yeah. Please, and yours. Well, let's say three questions, two more questioners after you.
Mr. Deedat, first of all, last year, November, some Muslim scholars, Muslim ulama, did contact the British government in connection with this book. So, like you did in South Africa, some scholars and some ulama tried to do it here, but they were unsuccessful through their Democratic Party. Secondly, you say Salman Rushdie, how he fooled the West. Well, all Muslims that are here are in the West, and they are part of the West. And as you have briefed us on how he has said abusive words to people, there's a lot of people here that are non-Muslims, and it is mainly on, you never use the word why they insulted Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The abusive language that he used and the technique that he used, he did not use the word Muhammad. Can you explain to me why you never brought up that word Muhammad and this? I don't know, maybe you can give it to me better? I don't know.
My brother, you see, I have discovered there's a wrong policy. Our policy now is wrong. He said, you know what he called my mother? Now what you're doing? You're spreading it now. Look, the thing has spread enough, it has harmed us enough. 40 Muslims have died, women have been all widowed, children orphaned, and now I'm going to say, you know what he called my mother? You know what he called my Nabi? You know what? What the hell? I said, forget it, man. That's the thing of the past. We have paid enough price for that. Now we say, look, you, sir, what is doing to you? Forget about what happened to us. Because you crying about yourself is making the guy happy.
But you must.
Why be a fool? You are a fool when you say, now talk about yourself because he's feeling happy. He said, right, he did it to you. Forget that. That's a thing of the past. I know how I feel, how you feel.
Because you must understand that there is non-Muslims also here. That's why they wanted to know why we...
Don't waste
Muslims
time. Don't waste time. Go for the kill.
Before we have the last two questions, I would like to take this opportunity, of course, to thank Sheikh Ahmed Deedat for all this time that he has given us. I'd also like to thank the organizers, Brother Shamshad Khan of the Islamic Propagation Center International, and members of his team who have worked so relentlessly, especially Brother Khadim Hussein, Brother Saeed, and Brother Majid Dodi, to make this event a success. Okay, if we could have the next questioner, please. Yes, if everyone after the last questioner can really go and sit down, because we just don't have any more time to answer your questions. Yes, this is the first one, and there is one person after him. And, everybody, I'm sure, it's so nice that you do have questions, but unfortunately, we have to have some time to cut off the program. So. There'll be two more questions, this gentleman and one more, and the rest, if you could please sit down, and perhaps we'll have there will be other programs this week, and your questions perhaps will be answered at those. Yes, sir?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muhammad Salim Dadabai. I wanted to ask Ahmed Deedat, is why the Saudi government and the rest of the Arab world did not support the Iranian in order to stop these Salman Rushdie books?
You think I know people's minds? I don't. This is the question you should ask them. Look, the question, the person who does or who doesn't, you ask him the question.
Why? No, the problem is
so
that.
Do you have a question on the topic? Because we have not discussing international politics.
By talking or merely understanding the West, because the West have conspired against Islam in
this
unity.
Might make a very
and we
interesting,
as a Muslim are not united.
This might make a very interesting topic in the future, but unfortunately it's not the topic here. Yes, could we please have the last questioner? Or a pair of questioners?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Farhana, and this is my friend Shazia. She'd like to ask you a question.
Well, it's more advice than question.
Do you have a question other than advice? Because there are people here that have questions.
Yeah, question. You haven't heard it yet.
I put two questions to my teachers in the school. It was one of freedom of speech, and I said, wasn't the last Temptation of Christ banned in this country? Am I wrong?
Yes, you're wrong. It's not banned.
What was it?
It was banned. So why isn't this book
being banned? Also, democracy. Wasn't the last Temptation of Christ banned in Pakistan? And also, wasn't Satanic Verses banned in Pakistan? Isn't that respect to Christians and respect to Muslims? And that's all we demand, respect.
But what is your question?
My question is, why was I called into the head's office twice, and the second time I was asked, if I carry on like this, fighting for Islam, what, I'll have to get chucked out? I mean, am I doing anything wrong?
No, you're not.
So why am I getting chucked out? If I do anything again, then I'm dead, aren't I?
Yeah, and we want to know.
Tell me I'm doing something wrong, then I'll stop. But isn't this for Islam?
I would like to wish each and every one of you, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.